you will hear a tutor and a student discussing a seminar.
Listen carefully to the first part of the conversation and answer questions 1.
First, you have some time to look at questions 1 to 5.
Come in!
Hi!
Oh, hello, Ahmed. How are you?
Fine, thanks.
Have a seat. So, how do you think the seminar went last week?
Oh, well, I enjoyed it, yes, though I'm not sure I really followed parts of the discussion that took place. You know, about the theory and all that.
Well, we can talk about that later, but were you comfortable in a group?
Oh, it's better, I think, than working on your own, though you're comparing yourself all the time with the other students there.
Okay. Well, let's talk about how you did and look at some strategies to help you in the future.
That would be great.
Now, one of the things that students often overlook when they go to seminars is that you do need to prepare for them. You can't rely on other people.
I know, and I did look at the results of the experiments we did in class and write them up beforehand, as you said.
Yes, and that was good. It made it easier to analyze them. But you have to do some background reading as well. Did you get the list of articles I sent round?
Mm-hmm. I've started to read them.
Okay, well, you'll know that for next time.
Yes, yes, sure.
So, let's move on to your participation in the seminar.
Right.
Perhaps you can tell me how you think that went.
Yeah, well, I'm not used to talking to more than a couple of people. It's very different from the way we learn in my home country.
Yes, I appreciate that.
So I think I know I should have included everyone, but I think I kept turning to the person next to me.
Is that because you were avoiding eye contact?
I don't think so. I'm not shy. It's just habit, I think.
Well, that will improve as we do more seminars.
Uh-huh.
Another difficulty is knowing when to speak.
Like when it's your turn?
Yes.
Yeah. I felt I did wait for a pause.
Yes, you handled that quite well.
The thing I'm really concerned about is keeping up with the discussion.
Ah, does your mind wander off?
Sometimes. I jot down a lot of information, but I still find myself thinking about something else when lots of other students are talking.
If there's an assignment to do at the end of a group, that usually helps.
I'm sure it does.
Okay. Now, the last thing I want to look at is the role that you play in the seminar.
What do you mean?
Well, when students work in groups, they don't all behave the same way. Some students are quiet, some look for support, some ask a lot of questions.
Oh, that's a new idea to me. I don't know what I'm like.
That's probably because you're thinking about your own performance all the time.
I guess so. I mean, should I be different in some way?
What I would say is that when we do the next seminar, you should look more at the people around you. You know, look outside yourself.
Like ask myself how they feel?
Yes, or what they're looking for from the group.
Okay.
It doesn't take much, but it's important to watch what other students are doing.
Okay, I'll do that.
Fine. Now, I'm going to suggest a couple of strategies for next week's seminar.
Okay. That's great. I need to participate more.
Well, it's not a question of saying more, but we need everyone to feel comfortable about giving their views.
Then the discussion is better.
Yes. So, you're a confident person.
Should I make sure I'm near someone who's quiet?
You can do, but it's more about how well you pay attention to other students.
Okay, so I need to be attentive.
Yes, and then encourage someone else to say more by saying, what did you mean when you said, or what do you think about the idea that...
That way I'm talking.
Yes, but you'll find that other people will talk too. You'll all start to get really involved.
Right. They're good suggestions.
The other thing that can really help is the way you take notes.
Yeah, I know I write down everything, but I should be stricter with myself.
Well, you actually need to think a few days ahead.
Really?
Yes. What's the topic, and what's the best way of making notes?
I see. So I have a strategy when I walk in the room.
Exactly. Mm. Then when you read through them later, they'll make sense, and you won't have to write them out again.
I always have to do that.
The other thing I would say is that you should include a small column in your notes where you can jot down things you want to go back to before the seminar ends.
Like a reminder?
Yes. Notes aren't just for later. You can use them as a prompt when there's a pause in the discussion.
That's been really helpful.
Okay. See you in class tomorrow.
Thanks.
That is the end of part one.
You now have half a minute to check your answers. You will now listen to the second part of the talk.
You have 30 seconds to look at questions 1 to 6.
Continue our series on ecology and conservation with a look at a particularly endangered member of the black bear family. 1 in 10 black bears is actually born with a white coat, which is the result of a special gene that surfaces in a few. Local people have named it the spirit bear, and according to the legends of these communities, its snowy fur brings with it a special power. Because of this, it has always been highly regarded by them, so much that they do not speak of seeing it to anyone else. It is their way of protecting it when strangers visit the area. The white bear's habitat is quite interesting. The bear's strong relationship with the old-growth rainforest is a complex one. The white bear relies on the huge, centuries-old trees in the forest in many ways. For example, the old-growth trees have extremely long roots that help prevent erosion of the soil along the banks of the many fish streams. Keeping these banks intact is important because these streams are home to salmon, which are the bear's main food source. In return, the bear's feeding habits nurture the forest. As the bears eat the salmon, they discard the skin and bones in great amounts on the forest floor, which provide vital nutrients. These produce lush vegetation that sustains thousands of other types of life forms, from birds to insects and more. Today, the spirit bear lives off the coast of the province of British Columbia on a few islands. There is great concern for their survival, since it is estimated that less than 200 of these white bears remain. The best way to protect them is to make every effort to preserve the delicate balance of their forest environment. In other words, their ecosystem. The greatest threat to the bear's existence is the loss of its habitat. Over many years, logging companies have stripped the land by cutting down a large number of trees. In addition, they have built roads which have fractured the areas where the bear usually feeds, and many hibernation sites have also been lost. The logging of the trees along the streams has damaged the places where the bears fish. To make matters worse, the number of salmon in those streams is declining, because there is no legal limit on fishing at the moment. All these influences have a negative impact on the spirit bear's very existence, which is made all the more fragile by the fact that reproduction among these bears has always been disappointingly low. And so, what's the situation going forward? Community organizations, environmental groups, and the British Columbia government are now working together on the problem. The government is now requiring logging companies to adopt a better logging method, which is a positive step. However, these measures alone may not be sufficient to ensure a healthy population of the spirit bear in the future. Other steps also need to be taken. While it is important to maintain the spirit bear's habitat, there also needs to be more emphasis on its expansion. The move is justified as it will also create space for other bears.
That is the end of part two.
You now have half a minute to check your answers.